Hello, everybody. It is I, Christopher. I have returned to read Psalm 25 a little later today. Usually it's in the morning early. I'm going to try and stay nice and early in the morning so I could publish them throughout the day, even when I'm working. I'm still on holidays. I have 4 weeks off of holidays, so needed. As I haven't had a vacation in a year after being laid off from my job for 6 months because I won't go into it on this because I get flagged or something, but I'm sure you can assume what it's about if I'm not going to talk about it. Self-censor, right? So I'll try and stick with it every morning. Get up early, spend time with the Lord, do this, and then I'll be able to stick to a definite everyday thing. I would like to have consistency, and Lord willing, by His grace, I will do it, and I will, continue to grow. And anyway, so I thought I would show my other cup. This is from Answers in Genesis, Canada, because I'm a Canadian, but they have it in U.S. too. So it's got the seven C's in God's eternal plan. So the first one is creation, then corruption, Adam fell in the garden, and then catastrophe, God flooded the earth because sin abounded, only saved Noah, then confusion, after God flooded the earth, they still disobeyed him and wanted to build their own city, make a name for themselves, and not spread across the earth. So God confused their language and forced them to spread across the earth. Then the Christ, Jesus, came, lived perfect and holy, and fulfilled what the first Adam failed to do. Then he died for the sins of the world, of all who would believe in him. And then the consummation, which is soon to come, a new heaven and a new earth. Hallelujah, what we look forward to. A world in which righteousness dwells, as Peter says. Oh, it's coming. Thank you, Jesus. I was walking through the beautiful marsh yesterday and just loving it and just thinking how beautiful it was. And I was reading a John G. Lake complete works, whatever, from Robert Lyerden. I have it in e-book. I also have the book, like the physical book, nice big thick one. But so I was reading that, and I was sitting on this bench in front of this beautiful pond, and in the marsh, like it's the whole marsh. Like they have different pools, I guess, for the marshes, and the water drains in, and it's just beautiful. There's birds, and it's nice and peaceful. And I was reading this account of John G. Lake talking about where he was explaining about how John G. Lake was going to go pray for a woman who was invalid. She had inflammatory rheumatism, and they had been seeking God for the baptism of the Holy Spirit for a while. John G. Lake was already healing the sick, and then they started seeking him for the baptism of the Spirit, like they had read in Acts. And then he was going to go pray for this woman with this other minister. And the other minister was talking to the woman, and John G. Lake was in this room, and he felt like this flow I picture it like liquid honey pouring over him, and then a great calm, and it went through his body, and he thought he heard the Lord say, "I've heard your prayers, I've heard your cries, you are now baptized in the Holy Spirit." And then they healed the woman, so I was reading that account, and all of a sudden this wind stirred up, and I was thinking about, like, while this wind was coming, I was thinking about Acts 2, when the Holy Spirit was poured out upon the disciples in the upper room as they prayed and sought the Lord for the promise of the Holy Spirit. And the wind was so, it was amazing, because I was sitting there reading this. It was just in the middle of me starting to read this account. And while I was reading this account, this was happening. This wind was blowing over me, and I could hear it in a distance. It sounded like a mighty rushing wind. And I just stopped reading in the middle of this paragraph that was talking about John getting baptized with the Holy Spirit. And I just closed my eyes and I just imagined the disciples in the upper room and that mighty rushing wind coming. And it was like I could hear that mighty rushing wind. I don't know if it was like my imagination, like that's what I was thinking after, but it was so amazing. And then these unclean thoughts came to me. It's like, what the heck? What's going on? Get away from me, you devil. And then I read the account, finished reading the account, and then the wind stopped and it didn't happen again. And then slowly after I was reading, then these people came by and there was children and they were really noisy and kind of disrupted my peace, and I got up and walked away. And then so that was just amazing to me. That was so beautiful. So as I was walking away, I was walking through the marsh, through this one trail, thinking how beautiful this place is and how it's going to be like the new heaven and the new earth. And it's my favorite place on earth, I think. It's there's some videos on my account that you can see where I'm at there. So I'm walking and I look down on the ground and there's these little stickers, different colors, and they're all little male penises. I'm like, what? I'm in this middle of this beautiful place, and there's this whole bunch of these little male... It was so gross. I was just like, it ruined my day. Not ruined my day, it ruined my moment. I was like, man, Lord Jesus, come back. We want to live in a place where it's beautiful and it's free of sin and unrighteousness and just... You and glory and righteousness and holiness and Jesus was anointed with the oil of gladness, I think it says, because he loved righteousness and he hated wickedness. God hates wickedness. And when you have him as your Lord and Savior, you begin to hate wickedness. A Christian cannot walk in sin. In peace. You cannot do things and have peace. You cannot. Your nature has changed. You become a new creation. You become righteous. And if you fall, it just grieves you. And it grieves you that you grieve the Holy Spirit that lives in you. You are the temple of God. And God, you have become one spirit with God. And it grieves you that you grieved him. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Oh, Lord, thank you. So anyway, the gospel of Jesus Christ is that Adam sinned in the garden. He broke the law of God and brought sin in, and death came with sin. Adam, he fell. He listened to his wife instead of God. Eve was deceived by the serpent, the devil, who was cast out of heaven because of sin. Sin abounded so much that God decided to destroy the earth. He flooded the earth. He killed everybody. All flesh, all the birds of the air died, except for Noah and his family, 8 people, that they found grace in the eyes of the Lord. God spread the people across the earth by confusing their language because they obeyed him again and continue to. We continue to. We are such fallible humans. We are so corrupt. We're all sinners. We're born in it. It's our nature. We cannot escape it. Without a Savior, without being transformed and born new, we cannot become acceptable in God's holy eyes. We cannot be entering into heaven except for someone to pay for us to do that. Because if we have all broken the law of God and we're all guilty before him. When God created us, he gave us an eternal spirit that will live forever. And it'll be in one place or the other. Either punishment, eternal punishment, or eternal life with God. Free of sin, pain, tears, sorrow. just joy and righteousness and relationship with God, the God who created us, a restoration of all things, the beautiful, perfect garden restored with a new heaven and a new earth. Then Christ came, the promised Messiah. He was prophesied throughout the Old Testament in hundreds of prophecies he fulfilled in his first coming. His first coming was to seek and save the lost, that he would provide the sacrifice for mankind, that they could be forgiven of their sins and be restored to God through the Holy Spirit. By grace, through faith, it is a gift, not of works, that anyone can boast. So that we may walk like Jesus, and we walk like Jesus through faith. Just as we received him, we also walk in him through faith, by faith. Christ died on the cross. He was delivered up by the Jews. They rejected him to the Romans. The Romans whipped him, beat him, had his flesh torn off his back. He fulfilled prophecy in that. It says that by his wounds we are healed, that he bore our sicknesses and carried our pains. By his wounds we are healed, that he bore our iniquities. He carried our sin upon himself. The judgment and wrath that we all deserve was poured out upon his human man, this fully God, fully man, human being who never sinned, who kept the law of God perfect to a T. It was poured out upon him. And if you believe in that, first he was crucified, nailed to the cross by his hands and feet, where he died, and then he was pierced in his side and outflowed blood and water, and then he was buried in a grave for 3 days. He remained there, and then he resurrected from the dead. He showed that eternal life could be given to all who trust in him. He defeated death. He resurrected from the dead. He is the firstborn of all creation. He is not a created being. He is the creator. But he, as a human who became a human so that he could redeem humans, he had to come as them, just like them, to walk like them so that he could fulfill the law of God in himself and then sacrifice himself, having his blood shed, him bearing our sin so that we could receive his righteousness as a transfer, a gift. We put our trust and faith in him. We will receive his righteousness. We will be born again, no longer born in sin, no longer a sinner from nature, but instead being given a new nature, one that is righteous, one that loves God and seeks God and obeys God and abides in God and continually grows in him and is wooed by him and then encounters him in various ways and hearing his voice and he's so good. He is the only one that can satisfy the human heart. If you are in sorrow, you are in pain, you are suffering, you are empty and alone, or you just feel so like there has to be more, he is the one that can fulfill that emptiness. He created everyone, I think, with a God-shaped hole in our body, in our heart, in our spirit, that we all yearn for that, but we go after other things because of our rebellion and our sin. But if we turn to him, we have that place in our being fulfilled by the one who created it. And it brings the only satisfaction that can fulfill. And it's from the Creator. It's from the Messiah, Jesus Christ. It's from our Father in heaven, God, who is Spirit, from the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of the Father, who's given to all who believe in Jesus. He is the guarantee, the down payment of our inheritance in the future, that purchased possession, that he purchased our bodies by his own body, his own blood shed on the cross. And we're going to have an eternal glorified body like he had. After he resurrected from the dead, he appeared in places instantly. He went into rooms that were locked. He appeared in different forms. He levitated into the air. He ascended back to heaven. We'll receive a body like that. And he told his disciples to wait in Jerusalem for the promise of the Father. The Holy Spirit was poured out, just like I was speaking about earlier. by power. They started preaching the word of God with power, by the power of the Holy Spirit, and God confirmed the word with signs and wonders following. And he does that today too, to all those who believe. You just believe, obey, and do, and he does it through you. Because he is true, he is not a liar, he's the only one who cannot lie. It is impossible for God to lie. His word is true. You believe it and you obey it, and he will confirm it. He will do it. He will do it through you. He will heal you. He will deliver you. He will heal others through you. He will deliver others through you. He will preach the gospel through you. He will do what he has purposed to do in you. He made it possible for you to walk in works that he prepared beforehand that you should walk in them by his Spirit, by abiding in him and abiding in his word. Jesus said that if you abide in me and you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. And that you abide in him, fruit will happen. He will cause the fruit to grow. And he prunes that tree, he prunes that vine so that it grows more fruit. The things that hinder that, he gets rid of that. He changes us and makes us more like him every day as we abide in him, as we trust in him. We abide in his word. Thank you, Lord. So, believe that and be saved. Receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Receive the one who will comfort you, who will speak to you the truth, who will lead you into all truth, and who will be with you forever. It's the Holy Spirit. Some people get possessed by unclean, evil spirits, and they torment them and lie to them and deceive them. But this is the Holy Spirit. This is the Spirit of God. This is the eternal Spirit that is given to all who are born of God, who are believing in Jesus and obeying Jesus. It says that in Acts, that he's given to all who obey the Lord. That it's not just a belief, a thought in your mind that you think, okay, that's true, I believe, I agree with it. You actually give it over to your whole being, give it over to that, and then you start to walk in that. You are start to obey Jesus. You start to obey his word, and the Spirit is given to all who obey him. But it's by faith. It's still by faith. It's not something you earn. It's not because of what you do that you receive the Spirit or that you receive salvation. It is by the gift that is given to you. If you just receive it, believe it, you will have it. All who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. If you confess Jesus as Lord and you believe that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And you confess him as Lord because your life follows that he is your Lord and you obey him. So do that and be entering into the kingdom of God, entering into the family of God, become a child of God, one with him forever, and one with your brothers and sisters in Christ, that God is building a house, a spiritual house for himself in his body. He is the head of his body. All those saints who formerly were sinners now become saints. He lives in them, and we are living stones. We are the chosen generation, a royal priesthood, God's chosen place to dwell. He dwells with us. He will walk in us. He will walk through us. But if you do not believe, you do not repent and turn from your wicked ways and follow him, you will have to die and pay for your own sins. The shedding of your own blood will have to be done. And your sin will be paid by yourself, and it will be a place of torment. Initially in hell, a place of torment, then you'll be resurrected and then cast into a lake of fire forever, where Satan and the fallen angels will be cast, and all who are not written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So believe. In Jesus' name. So if you need healing or pain deliverance or deliverance from evil spirits, unclean spirits that are tormenting you, because of what Jesus did, I believe, I speak to your body that it will be delivered. It will be made whole because he already paid for it. And he confirms his word. He is the healer. He will heal you and deliver you right now. I was thinking earlier, silver and gold have not. What I have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, be free, be healed, be made whole right now in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Psalm 25. That was longer than I planned. I was going to try to do short. Psalm 25. A plea for deliverance and forgiveness. A psalm of David. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, I trust in you. Let me not be ashamed. Let not my enemies triumph over me. Indeed, let no one who waits on you be ashamed. Let those be ashamed who deal treacherously without cause. Show me your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. On you I wait all the day. Remember, O Lord, your tender mercies and your loving kindness, for they are from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth, nor my transgressions. According to your mercy, remember me, for your goodness' sake, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord, therefore he teaches sinners in the way. The humble he guides in justice, and the humble he teaches his way. All the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth, to such as keep his covenant and his testimonies. For your name's sake, O Lord, pardon my iniquity, for it is great. Who is the man who fears the Lord? Him shall he teach in the way he chooses. He himself shall dwell in prosperity, and his descendants shall inherit the earth. The secret of the Lord is with those who fear him, and he will show them his covenant. My eyes are ever toward the Lord, for he shall pluck my feet out of the net. Turn yourself to me and have mercy on me, for I am desolate and afflicted. The troubles of my heart have enlarged. Bring me out of my distresses. Look on my affliction and my pain, and forgive all my sins. Consider my enemies, for they are many, and they hate me with cruel hatred. Keep my soul and deliver me. Let me not be ashamed, for I put my trust in you. Let integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait for you. Redeem Israel, O God, out of all their troubles. Amen. So if you'd like to reach out to contact me in whatever way, you can go to lovesflame.com, which goes to my other website, and there's a contact us tab at the top that you can click on, or on the, if it's mobile, on the drop down, contact us, and I am there for you. I will pray for you or believe for you, with you, for whatever your need is, or if you'd just like to chat or whatever. All right, so until next time. Grace, peace, and love in Jesus Christ. Bye.